Let's start from the introduction. My name is Nikolai Golov, and all my life I'm building a data warehouses using different techniques, using different databases for different companies. So on the slide you can see that I have some experience with Teradata. In Teradata I use the Data Vault. After it, I had a great experience building an anchor modeling data warehouse on a Vertica. So it finally its size reached almost 500 terabytes. And currently, I'm working for a ManyChat. It's a California-based startup. It's a leader in the world of chatbot marketing. For ManyChat, I'm also building a data warehouse. I simply cannot. I simply don't know anything beside building a data warehouse. And for ManyChat, I build a data warehouse using a Snowflake and slightly modified version of anchor modeling. So currently, I'm a head of data engineering of ManyChat. I have a team of about six engineers who are helping me to do it. But it is not all. Also, I'm a lecturer in university. Currently, I'm a lecturer at the Harbour Space University in Barcelona. And also, I'm working as a consultant, helping other companies to launch their data platform, to launch their data warehouse, to upstart their analytics. Why it is important here? Because here you can see that I started from Data Vault and I switched to anchor modeling. Does it mean that I understand that anchor modeling is definitely much better than a Data Vault? So personally, I think that it is better, but there are some aspects. Because if I am asked to build a data warehouse for a company which hired me for a full-time job, I will definitely choose an anchor modeling. I will definitely choose an anchor modeling if I am able to spend, for example, 8 hours on optimization, on solving some technical issues. Because anchor modeling is much, much better in terms of modeling, in terms of automatization and all this stuff. But if I'm working as a consultant, if I'm helping a company, for example, 1 hour per week, I currently will not recommend them to start from anchor modeling, because Data Vault is simpler to understand, is simpler to implement, and there are more existing tools which supports Data Vault. So what does it mean? Currently, I'm working with a lot of companies all over the world, and I have experience of solving same task using an anchor modeling and using a Data Vault. And in this presentation, I will try to illustrate you what issues can you face in working with Data Vault or with anchor modeling, and how they can be overcome using approaches from a different methodologies. Because in my understanding, Data Vault and anchor modeling, it's like two parts of the whole. It's all about modeling, which are slightly moving from one another, like transforming from one to another. Also, small moment which I also want to focus your attention on. If you watch the data sizes of the data warehouses on the slide, you can see that those data warehouses, they are pretty big. So 500 terabytes for anchor modeling on Vertica. Currently, we are almost reached 250 terabytes. So it's a huge databases. It's databases which you can call a big data. And by the way, if I wouldn't use a anchor modeling a Data Vault, I would definitely have a petabytes of data there. So it's a slightly specific area, but I suppose you will be happy to see that it is possible to use both Data Vault and anchor modeling in such cases. So let's go to the questions. Let's go to the issues which you face. And let's go to the answers. Let's go to the solutions which can overcome those issues. So first question of data vault, I suppose it's a question which all of you faced. It's a question, how many satellites shall you create? For example, here you can see a customer, and customer have like a pretty obvious field, like name, gender, type, all this stuff. Question is, how many satellites to create? Originally, Delvin Lindstedt offers us an answer. He says, create split satellites according to frequency of changes. Frequently changed attributes shall live in the separate satellite. Answer was good, but now we have other argument which shall be taken into consideration. Because today, everybody likes microservices. Everybody likes demand-driven design. Everybody likes splitting their entity into different services which process them. So what if our customer is processed not by one system, but by two systems? For example, one system provides name and gender, and second system provides a type, for example, type of the customer. In this case, if you combine those attributes together in one satellite, you will immediately face a limitation, because you will not be able to upload data from different systems independently. So here is example, I've got a row about Mike. I got an information that he is a female, it's a synthetic example. But if all attributes are stored inside a single satellite, I have to wait information from other system to understand type of mic to upload this. So it means that if you combine attributes from different system into one satellites, you lose the ability to upload data from systems independently, and the frequency of updates is will be limited by the slowest possible system. For example, in one company which I helped previous year, it's a pretty big company, it's like international one. They have information about customers, but some fields are populated manually, one per week. What does it mean? It means that satellites for a customer is uploaded only once per week, because the frequency of updates is limited by just one system. But if you split your satellites according to a source system, this limitation will be removed. So currently I can say that if you have a, for example, how many satellites shall you create? Answer, at least as many satellites as you have a source system for an attributes. So for example, in this example two. But one of the most complex aspect of a real system is that reality is changing. What does it mean? We started from two source system, but imagine that at some moment somebody implemented a third system, because for example some developers they just read a lot of articles about microservices and decided that their service is too big, they shall be split, and they separated a system which stores information about gender to a different source system. What does it mean? It means that inside our data warehouse we shall split satellites in two. I don't know how many of you have experience with splitting real satellites with data, but it is not very pleasant operation. So it's a risk. Risk of creating, of emerging of new source system. Also, we have other risks, especially for a rapidly evolving system. What if we got a new attribute for a customer? What if, for example, what if they just added a birth date for our customer, new field, which started populating from some moment of time? So previously we hadn't it, we haven't got such information, but from some point of view, we have started getting it. What does it mean? I suppose you think that if somebody of you worked with it, you understand that obvious choice to of just adding a field to a satellite, just adding a birthday to a satellite of a customer, it's a very dangerous option because all historicity can be broken. So it is a complex topic. I just want to illustrate it. So if a new field emerges, you will immediately face an issue. So what if you get a row which is completely identical to a previously available row, even with a like date and all the stuff, but with a new field available? Is it a new row or an old one? So is it a change or not? And to avoid such issue, I want to recommend you, if a new attribute is added, you shall add it to a separate satellite. It is a pretty safe option. So we just studied this question. Question number one, how many satellites? And I hope that I give you the feeling that this question is complex. You shall think about it. You shall spend some mind resources finding a solution. And what answer can we get from other methodologies? What answer can we get from anchor modeling? Answer is super simple. One attribute in separate satellite. Each attribute in a separate satellite. What does it mean? If we have a customer with six possible attributes, we shall create six possible satellites. You can say that it will produce a lot of tables. I can say yes, but not that big. And you can definitely live with it. And by the way, in this approach, you are completely free of any issues with splitting satellites into of working with new attributes. Everything is automated. I like automation. That is why I mostly prefer this approach to the data vault one. And by the way, here we can go to the moment. I suppose here I can get. I will need a small help from a Christian. So Christian, help me please. Imagine that you created a data vault data model for users. So I'm analysts and I have come to you and I asked, Christian, where can I find name of each user? How this question can be answered?
So the name is an attribute of the user. So probably we have some kind of satellite where we find names of users or multiple satellites.
Yes.
Depending on the setup, yeah.
Yes, one of satellites, but I'm analyst. I'm like I one of the 100 analysts in the big company, for some companies which I worked at, they really had hundreds of analysts. So how they can get an answer, which satellite to use? What tool can you offer them to answer this question?
To be honest, I'm not sure what you're getting at.
The idea is to avoid answering such questions manually, you shall think about some tool where analysts can find in which satellite lives attribute which he needs. Just imagine you have a user, you have, for example, five satellites of a user. Where do we have a name? In first one, in second one, in third one? It's a question which shall be answered. And that is why normal data vault, it requires some tool which helps you to discover attributes, like the task of data discovery. I suppose you understand it. And I ask him this question to illustrate how this situation can be solved differently if you choose the approach of anchor modeling, if you choose an approach of one attribute per satellite. In this case, the question is the answer, because I already know everything that I need. I know that I need a name of a user. What does it mean? It means that it shall be stored in the table named A, because it's attribute, user, because of a user, name. And those table, it shall contain following columns. It shall contain user ID, definitely surrogate key, name, value, actual DT, it's like historicity, and technical fields like launch ID, source system ID, like technical information about source of data. I am illustrating you that in this case, analysts doesn't need additional tools to do a data discovery. All data discovery emerges automatically in his head if he just know correct words, if he just know that he know that he need name of a user. It's the idea. So let's go to the second question. So it was like first question, how many satellites? Let's go to the second question. How to identify a link? Because let me illustrate. Here is a like pretty classical approach. We have like buys, it's like a purchase, where a customer purchases a product in a shop. It's a synthetic example. And here we have satellites above satellite with a sum and amount above those link. But imagine situation that, for example, originally we got information about purchase that in shop 1, product 10 was purchased by customer 42. It is fine. It is pretty logical link. But what if usually because of some business process, which we didn't know before, it is possible that a purchase can be changed. That, for example, for some reason during those purchase, customer 42 purchased not a product 10, but a product 20. And in the case of Data Vault, if we use a classical link, such situation will lead to a creation of alternative role into the link without any ways of removing a previous link. So it is issue which can occur, the issue of identification a link which is identified technically by surrogate keys of its foreign keys. Here we have a possible answer from anchor modeling. Answer of anchor modeling is no satellites or links which shall point to another links. Just watch on this diagram. Here we created a purchase, the fact of purchase as a hub. This hub is connected by a link to the product, to the shop, and to the customer. And all the satellites, all the attributes of a link, which was previously attribute of a link, like sum or amount, are now created as an attributes for a hub. And by the way, in this case, we are able to store this purchase using no identified, not just by foreign keys, but by some internal business key of a purchase or a check number, something like it. If you watch on this diagram, you can see that it is not a specific anchor modeling one. Such diagram, such model can be created in Data Vault 2. It's just a little different approach, which creates more tables, but gives you some benefits, gives you some better support of historicity. So at this moment, you can think that I just simply describing the benefits of anchor modeling above Data Vault. But I strongly try to avoid this. I'm strongly try to be fair. And here I want to illustrate you one practical business situation, which I faced. Imagine that we have data about online visits. So you have a website, people visiting your website. So each visit, it's information about cookie, about URL, about referrer, about type of the visit, about date of the visit, about IP, user agent. I suppose you understand. So these types of information, it's called a clickstream. It is pretty popular type of data, which is used for all types of web analytics, for funnel analysis, for A/B tests, a lot of like analytics of websites. And how shall you model such data? How you shall model such structure? If you just simply select like unmodified anchor model, answer is that you shall create a hub for each visit, like visit event, which shall have a lot of attributes, a lot of links. So it's like a huge constellation created from a single row. It can be done, and I have done it. Moreover, I have done it, and I successfully implemented such process for a company who have initially it have like 100 million visits per day, after it 1 billion visits, and after it like few billion visits per day. It can be done by some magic tricks of query optimization. But think about it from a business point of view. Here you spend a huge amount of resources by first normalizing data, representing them into normalized structure, and after you denormalize them, because analysts, they simply need just a denormalized table of clickstream. Same story. And by the way, all those normalization, you can say that it is reasonable for some cases, but generally, you know, those visits, it's an events. They are unchangeable one. Events, they like bullets, like shots. No changes. They are not models really. And if you implement this using a strict rules of anchor modeling, you will need to do a lot of maybe not that necessary work. And because of it, for example, in ManyChat, I use a slightly different approach. In ManyChat, I made a step back from air anchor modeling to the data vault. I store each visit as a separate hub or anchor with a list of fields, row fields, which identifies it. And after it, I store all links, all external links to a cookie, to event type, to URL, combined to the structure, which you can call it a link. It is like complex link with a lot of foreign keys around. In ManyChat, we call this construction stream, because in ManyChat we use like anchors, we use attributes, we use ties as a normal anchor modeling, but we also have those stream for such events, for streams of unchangeable events with huge volumes and pretty complex structure. For example, for stream of messengers for a Facebook Messenger and Instagram Messenger, there are tens of billions of rows, and this approach works perfectly. This approach is also implemented it as a separate data modeling technique. They call it an activity schema. It is approach which says that you can model everything using just a single table, using just a stream table. So you can think about all those stuff as a different competitive approach, like anchor modeling with a stream or a link in a data vault or activity schema, but I simply advise you to think about it like a different facets of the single approach, which can make your modeling technique better if you adopt it wisely. Because here you can create such stream with only required field, and you have all flexibility of anchor modeling by adding like additional attributes and additional links around it, and it gives you huge flexibility to extend it as you get new events with new additional characteristics. By the way, in one companies in which I worked before, those clickstream eventually reached a 100 additional attributes. So that is why it can be important. So it was a question two, how to identify a link. Now let's go to the question three. How fast we can load data? I suppose all of you who worked with Data Vault, you understand that in Data Vault, we can, at the first step, we can upload all hubs in a single batch. After it, after all hubs are uploaded or updated or upsorted, you can load all satellites, which are satellites of hubs. And you can load all links which are linked to the hubs. So it's a second step. After it, if you have a satellite to a link, or if you have link to a link, you can you shall have a step three. And maybe if you have a satellite above link which points to another link, you can have step four and maybe some others. So here in my example, you can see that here we have a critical path equal to four. So four steps are needed to upload all our model. On step four, we have only one satellite. But generally, if you are uploading data in a loop, you shall wait till the last possible upsert operation will be over, till you switch to the next upsert loop. So in a data vault, you shall have, for example, three plus steps of parallel loading. What is the answer of anchor modeling to this question? How fast we can load? Answer of anchor modeling is two steps, because in anchor modeling, without satellites above links and without links pointing to a links, you are able to upload first all hubs, all anchors, and on a second step, you are able to upload all links or ties and all attributes or satellites. Pretty easy, just two steps, no more. It gives you an ability to upload your anchor modeling to actualize it very, very fast, really just a few minutes for a loop. It is possible. So I suppose you see that it looks not bad. But can we do better? Can we upload data in one step? Yes, we can. Because we have a Data Vault 2.0. It's just a simple illustration that there are always something which is better, which is faster than the tool which you used previously. How Data Vault 2.0 is working? Their idea is you just simply upload everything in a single batch. How it is achieved? Pretty simple. Why in an anchor modeling you need to wait till all hubs or anchors will be loaded? So here is an example. We have a single row arriving from a source system. We have a customer with some business key, C64XR, with a name Mike, who lives in New York, and time step of the record is 2nd February. So to upload such data into anchor modeling, we shall first upload all anchors or hubs. To get a surrogate keys, we shall upload a row to a customer table and to a city table. We shall know that C64XR is a 3 and New York it's a 13. And using this, and it is like step one. And after it, on the step two, we are, can upload a attribute name using surrogate key 3. And in parallel, we can upload link, which links our customer to the city where he lives. So two steps. How it can be done in one step using a data vault 2.0? It can be done using pretty smart idea of hashing trick. You can simply, because the idea, you need a separate step only because you need to get a surrogate keys, values of surrogate keys. But what if we can generate surrogate keys automatically? What if we generate surrogate key using a hash, using a MD5? So here is a real MD5 of C64XR and of New York. So knowing this MD5, we are able to upload correspondent role to the hubs or anchors, and without waiting to uploading anything to the hubs or anchors, we can upload a satellite or attribute and a link or a time. Sorry that I'm using both words from both words, because maybe it can help somebody to understand better what I'm talking about. So it was a question three. How fast we can load data? So it illustrates like what different approaches, what benefits they have, what risk. And by the way, about those approach with Data Vault 2.0, it is great, it is very beautiful, but I strongly recommend you to use it very accurately, because if you are using hash, it is a risk of the hash collisions. It was created for databases like Hadoop, where joins can be like complex, and where it is fine to lose some portion of the data, but if you are doing such a model, for example, for financial data, you can face some serious risk. So this approach is beautiful, but please use it very accurately. Next question. I suppose it's a really beautiful question why I love anchor modeling very strong. So question is, what identifies an entity? I suppose a lot of you face such issue implementing a data vault for a practical case. Just think about a car. What identifies a car? A number, but like car number those, but it can be changed. All parts of the car can be changed. Same story, speaking about people, you can say that person is identified by his like national ID, but he can get another national ID with different number. You can say that fingerprints identify person, but for some reason person can lose his fingers, or he can be burned, for some reason he can have issues with it. So it's an illustration is the illustration of the fact that in a real world, it is really hard to select a really unchangeable identifier of each entity. Because I suppose you know that each person at some age, for example, at 30 or 40 years, I don't remember, all cells of his body, they are different. So he haven't get any cell left from his birth, but he's still the same person. Everything has changed, but he's a still person. And it is exactly the same issue where Data Vault have issues. Because Data Vault, in my understanding, I don't know good ways to solve this problem. The problem of switching from identifying by one field to another one. And in anchor modeling, answer is very beautiful. Answer is what identifies fires an entity. Answer is all attributes with all historicity identifies a person. So a person is all information about his fingerprints, about his eyes, about his tooth, about his national IDs, all his photos, all of it identifies him. And you can work with such identification process as you want, giving you a great flexibility. What does it mean in practice? It means that in practice, you have a table anchor or a hub, which contains only surrogate key and maybe source system, but like a technical fields. So first of all, I think that this answer is extremely beautiful. First. Second, I suppose you have seen that I created a data warehouses which contains hundreds of terabytes of data. So I was forced to use all optimization steps which was available. And to be honest, I have never used this feature of anchor modeling. Never. Because Lars, in his tool, in implementation for such databases as a SQL Server, for Oracle, for PostgreSQL, he very smartly uses triggers, table valued functions, and views where you can insert. It is very beautiful, very efficient one, but the databases which I used for a big data, like Vertica, like a Snowflake, they simply don't have triggers. They don't have like table value functions and all the stuff which can simplify the process of working with such approach. And because of it, so this answer is great, it is beautiful, but I failed to use it for a big data. It's a question four. And now let me go to the last question. And after it, we can go to the answers. I hope that we will have some discussion. I hope that I haven't told you too many questions. So like first one was already forgotten. So question five, what for? What for we are doing all this stuff? What for we are doing this modeling? How it helps us in the long perspective? I suppose some of you have seen my article about why do shall we use a data modeling in the world of modern data stack? And here is one of the possible answers. Soon I will have an article about it. So let me illustrate the story of ManyChat. First chart is a data volumes inside a data warehouse of ManyChat. Here you can see pretty healthy growth of data volumes. So we started from zero as we started at the first January of 2020. By the way, perfect time before COVID, before everything. And after it, we started adding more entities. History is growing, everything is growing. When we started, ManyChat supported only chatbots, which worked with in Facebook Messenger. Now ManyChat supports emails, SMS, Instagram, WhatsApp, Telegram, huge amount of stuff. So data model is growing, business is growing, everything is growing, data are growing. So I suppose you understand it's normal life of the healthy data warehouse. Everything is growing. Data growing. Data usage also is growing. And just by the way, let me return. So here you can see the volumes of data, it exceeded 200 terabytes and now it is almost reached 250 terabytes and it continues growing. I suppose soon we will have 300 terabytes and all this stuff. I suppose we'll process, it will not end. Second part, this chart, sorry, no captions here. It's a amount of analytical queries per month. So we have more data, we hire more and more analysts, we create more and more Tableau dashboards, which analyze data. So each month we have more and more queries to our data warehouse. I suppose it is also pretty healthy picture. So we started, for example, from three analysts. Now we have almost 20 analysts and they are constantly like asking questions to our data. What if we do this? What if we do that? They are testing hypotheses, they are creating chart. So they are pretty busy. And now I suppose you can understand that data are growing, queries are growing. I suppose you shall expect that expenses will also grow, but no. Here is my favorite chart. I like it very much. It's a chart of weekly spends. And here you can see that originally they started to grow. They was growing, 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 growing. And at some moment in the August of 2020, we finalized like starting steps. We launched a basic automation. We switched to optimization steps. And after it, our spends, our weekly spends, they simply stopped. So currently we are spending in a week same amount of Snowflake credits, you can think about it as a dollars, as 2 years before. So we, our growths, our spends are simply not growing. Everything is growing. And by the way, even in August of 2020, our spends was rather small comparing to the, like, for example, Vertica of comparable sites. They were rather small, but they haven't changed. They are not changes, changing as we hire more analysts, as we add more and more data. And in my opinion, it is main answer to the question, what for we need tools like anchor modeling, which enables you to use an automation everywhere. Because in anchor modeling, you are able to, you are working with just four simple entities. You are working with anchors, with attribute, with a tie, and with a stream, like our special invention. And you are able to invent those optimization, integrate them into your automation, and simply be happy without growth of your expenses. And like as a final part, currently, why I'm telling you this part, because currently we are working on implementing those automation as a MVP of a software as a service, as a tool which we hope to offer other companies to use. And if for some reason you want to try, if you want to work with a Snowflake using all benefits of proper modeling in Snowflake, using a fully automated tool which will do everything for you, so here is a link. We will happy to start working with you. Our prototype is almost ready. And here you can see my contacts where you can write for me, my LinkedIn account. And here you can see all languages which you can use to ask me questions. I will have an issues with Spanish. You will have an issues with Chinese. But nevertheless, I will be extremely happy to answer all your questions. So thanks for your time. Hope you have some questions.